Well, you know, I was looking at this word, Harry Cohn. You know, I'm thinking of myself back in New York when I grew up with my Aunt Sadie Cohn. That was my aunt, my mother's sister. I grew up in Lower East Side on Cherry Street in the Village. And I used to work Sammy's Bowery Follies for Sammy Fuchs and Betsy. At Sammy's Bowery, I used to be the singing newsboy. Boy, Gus Edwards songs, those were the great days. And I really enjoyed myself living with my aunt at the time. My mother just dumped me to my aunt, and I grew up with her and went to school in the Village, worked at Sammy's Bowery Follies, and here I am sitting with Harry Cohn, the same spelling as my aunt, Harry Cohn. How are you?
I'm fine.
God, you're from Bronx, Brooklyn, grew up in the Bronx and the Brooklyn?
Yeah.
And with gangs, I mean, I'm looking at you. You said tough gangs.
Well, rough gangs in Brooklyn and Bronx, yeah.
But were you with the gangs at the time?
For a short while, yeah. To survive.
To survive, I like that word.
Yeah.
You had to be with the gangs to survive around Bronx.
If you weren't, you were on your own. If you were on your own, you're in trouble.
And you became a stuntman. You came to Hollywood, and you became a stuntman. What do you mean? And what?
Well, I came out here to work in films, but I did stunt work while I was trying to get some work.
Right.
And I had a contact with Stanley Kramer.
Right.
Director.
Wonderful.
And he was in Nuremberg doing Judgment in Nuremberg, doing the film. And he wasn't in Hollywood, so that kind of screwed me up. But I met his uncle, and I got to do some work. I worked in The Untouchables, Robert Stack, did a stairfall in that.
The original Untouchables.
On TV,
right.
1960.
Yeah, right.
And some war films with bombs blowing up and stuff like that, and falling out of cars. And then somebody... became friends with me, an actor named Tony Monaco.
Uh-huh.
He gave up acting. And he turned me on to acting. He said, you know, he heard me do some script reading, and he saw how I used to fool around and carry on. Mm-hmm. And he said, you know, you should go back to New York
and study. That's what I say
acting.
To the young actors today. When they come to here in California, I say immediately, go to New York, study, get the theater, work it, and then come. I let Hollywood send you.
Right.
Don't come here to make it.
Yeah.
I say, don't you believe that?
Yeah, I believe that you should study. You should
study.
Have a craft. Work on your craft.
So that's what Harry Cohn did. He went back to New York.
Back to New York.
Actor studio?
And I went to the studio later. I went first to Stella Adler.
The best.
I studied with Stella for 2 years when she was only 61, so I had a young, you know, fresh.
She was young. And her big chair, right?
And big chair.
I love that.
Big red chair.
Right.
With golden handles.
Uh-huh. I know all about it.
And she liked me a lot, and she gave me scholarships because I tried doing Shakespeare, and she knew that I was from the
Now, she doesn't
slums.
Usually do that. She did it because you just said the word, because she knew that you were from...
Well, from the bad neighborhoods, and I was trying to improve myself.
That's right.
And that when she gave assignments, instead of, you know, like she had assignments and she said you can pick either Williams or Shakespeare, and I used to take Shakespeare, and she thought that was really ballsy.
Because it is ballsy from a rough guy to do Shakespeare.
To do
Go
Shakespeare.
Ahead.
She loved that, and she gave me a scholarship in speech, and we became good friends, and I worked, and that's where I met Robert De Niro, and I did a scene with him at Stella's. It was his first acting school, and we did a scene from Home of the Brave.
Good.
And it got me into my summer stock company in New York, and he went traveling to Europe.
Right.
You know, he didn't want to stick around. And then I didn't see him for a long time. But I learned a lot from Stella, and she made me feel like an important human being. She brought me out of that slumpy, danger, rough
There's another interesting
thing.
Word you just said. She made you feel like a human being.
Yeah.
That's interesting what you said that. Why? Didn't you felt like you were a human being?
Well, I felt like I was, just somebody from the streets with hard knocks and everything was like out for war and fighting. And I didn't have much self-esteem, and I didn't have much feelings about myself as being important.
Right.
And because of the kind of person she was and her classes, she made you feel, me feel,
right.
that I was a much better human being than I was, that I was more important than I think I was.
Right.
And it made me read more, and I used to read because I never used to like to read, and go out to the theater, and then eventually to backpack in Europe. And
how did Elie Kazan get into your life, Elie Kazan?
Elie Kazan, he was directing a film called America, America.
Right.
which he
which
shot.
Which is one of his best,
one of his best films, yeah.
And it didn't get a lot of recognition.
No, it didn't. But he likes it the best because
that's his favorite.
It's his personal trip. And he shot in Greece. And when he came back to New York, he called Stellar up. They were very good friends. And he said, "Do you have any young guys that look Greek that could substitute for my shoeshine boys? Because I left them in Greece."
Right.
She says, "Yeah, I have this guy. He's Jewish, but he looks Greek, Harry Cohn."
Uh-huh.
So she sent me and a few other guys. And I got my SAG card from that. And I got to work with Kazan for a couple of days down at the docks down near the Hudson River.
Right.
Shooting in ice cold weather. And we were wearing nothing but rags because we were like Greek immigrants.
Uh-huh.
With holes in our shoes, freezing our asses off. And we had to come out of this off the boat from onto the pier saying,
right,
"America, America,"
uh-huh,
as if it was warm and beautiful and it was uh-huh freezing cold.
Uh-huh.
And I got to talk to Kazan a little bit, and he was my hero because of, Streetcar Named Desire and On the Waterfront. You know,
uh-huh,
he was part of the Actors Studio, which...
You joined eventually the Actors Studio after
Yeah,
that.
I auditioned.
You left Stella, and, you know, Stella's Adler and the Actors Studio, totally different.
Totally different.
People don't know that.
Exactly.
What is the difference?
I'll tell you the difference. The difference is that Stella Adler works a lot with the imagination. She wants the actors to use the imagination, and she's very, very strong about
right
working on character and finding out the character's choice and the character's walk, the character's, speech. Where the Actor's Studio, which is very personal, and I'm glad to have both.
Uh-huh.
I think everyone should have both. The Actor's Studio becomes very personal, very involved with your personal problems or personal... commitment on how you feel when you were young and what mm-hmm happened when you were like in a situation when someone got...
It's a living thing.
And it brings a lot of a personal pain.
Right.
Stella was not for that. She felt that if you got too involved, too personal, like why she was against the effect of memory. And
she was, really.
She's totally against it. And Shelley Winters was for it. She loved it. And Shelley studied with Stella, too.
Shelley did study with Stella?
Yeah.
See, it's good. I think it's good to have both. Am I right?
Exactly, yeah. And Stella was like somebody who made you feel like you had to know about the theater. You had to read Chekhov and
right
Ibsen and Strindberg and O'Neill and the Theater of the Absurd and understand the different kinds of approach to the writing because each writer writes a different style, different
right
way.
Right, right.
And also, actors today, they rush for the TV and they want to be stars, and they don't really go to find out what the background of theater, what the art is, what the real, where it all came from.
Yes.
Like Stella came from the Yiddish theater, her father,
She did. She came from the Jewish theater on 2nd Avenue, wasn't it?
Yeah,
something like
Halsted
that?
Street, yeah.
Yeah, on Halsted Street,
yeah,
where I lived around that area.
That's a great avenue, yeah.
That Jewish theater was great.
Yeah.
So anyway, go ahead.
And Katz's Delicatessen.
Oh, no.
So that's really... that made me feel really good when I studied with her and got this background feeling of all these great writers and
right
and doing scenes with from O'Neill and Chekhov and the Seagull and things like that. And when you left after 2 years, a good tough 2 years with her, I took body movement and speech and all that, and I kind of lost a little of my New York accent, not
right,
all, but I
right
still have a little the accent.
You'll never lose that, Harry Cohn.
No, but
believe me, I'm looking at you. You'll never lose that New York accent,
no,
which is great. Keep
it's
it
great.
Regardless.
The only problem is it sometimes kept me from doing Westerns because I walked in and tried to do a cowboy, and they said, "We don't want a New York cowboy. We want a Texan."
Harry Cohn, but you did something I really like. You know what you did? You did the same as I did. I packed my bags, and I got on the plane and trains and boats, and I traveled all over the world.
Yeah.
I went to Europe. You did the same thing.
Yeah.
This is in the 60s, where the hippie days, all the hippies, I remember them so well, when we just traveled, our packbacks,
great,
gone all over. Yeah. Tell me about your experiences.
Well, I was living in California, and I sold my van, and I was really not accomplishing much at the time. Excuse me.
But good experience to get out of here.
But
go ahead.
I wanted to see the world. I wanted to learn what the hell was going on the other side before I got too old, because backpacking can be rough. You have to hitchhike. You have to live in the cold weather and the rain and all that,
Harry,
which I did.
It can be cold and rough, but it's wonderful.
It's great.
And you've had some good times.
I did 10 months right? of it. 10 months of it.
I've had them too. Go
20
ahead.
Countries.
And I've never have regrets for that.
And I covered a lot of Europe, Paris, and England, and all that, and
India.
And Italy and Spain. And then when I went to India, I went to Nepal, which is
where the Beatles
Mount
were
Everest.
And all that, and carried on.
And I got to do a lot of trekking in the mountains and the woods, and slept with yaks and with Tibetans, and drank their homemade beer they had, what they make with milk.
Was Harry Cohn afraid? You did it by yourself. I did it too.
At times
I were.
Were
you afraid?
There were times, yeah.
Were you
because
afraid of your life?
You feel like there's no telephone to go to. You can't get a subway. You're on your own.
You are.
And I didn't know anybody. I went alone. I went completely alone. And I went through Afghanistan also, you know.
Enough
and I went
rough
to
country.
Kabul
rough.
Before they had the takeover. They had a coup there in 1973, and I was there in 72, just before the coup.
Uh-huh.
And I went to Pakistan and then finally
Morocco.
Morocco and Algiers and Tunisia.
Algiers is tough, but Morocco, I had a great time. I love Morocco.
Morocco was great.
Kenitria and I love Afghanistan. I love Morocco. I took a train from Tunis across.
From Tunis
to Algeria.
Yeah, that's
past
a great,
Algeria.
That's a good, yeah.
Did you go to Spain too?
They had
too?
A cholera there, and it was dangerous. I was lucky I didn't get any disease, you know.
So you traveled 10 months of this.
I did backpack. I took no plane. Once I got to Europe, once I got overseas,
right.
Everything was either buses, trains, hitchhiking, and.
What happened to Harry Cohn when you returned back to America? Met Robert De Niro again? What happened?
I went to New York. I got involved with the Actors Studio.
In New York.
Became an observer. I was working there as an observer. And then I finally took an audition. I passed it. Mm-hmm. And then I passed my finals after two times. And the second time that I passed the final, Susan Strasberg.
One great.
Who became good friends. We became, matter of fact, I worked twice with Susan.
I love Susan.
I did a film and a TV with her.
We just lost her, right?
Yeah,
yeah,
we did.
Go ahead.
We lost a beautiful human being.
She was.
Well, Susan kind of like told Lee Strasberg at the final, they liked my work. I mean, I did a great scene. But he said, who is Harry Cohn? I know he's not a star. He's never studied with me.
Was Lee that way?
Was Lee really that way? I mean,
was he a star kisser like?
A little bit, and he was like into people who had good credits and you know had big film credits, and also very very pretty girls. He loved pretty girls.
Did he really?
Some girls can get in without even acting. But Susan told Lee that she says, "Daddy, listen, this is what." John Strasberg told me. He told me this. The brother. He said, my sister back, you know, the reason why you got in, what helped get you in, I mean, you're a great actor.
Right.
Is that she told Lee that you're a good writer, that you write poetry and stuff. Because I did some poetry at the Actors Studio. Mm-hmm. And Diane Ladd was there, and she loved it, you know. Mm-hmm. And Susan loved it, and I gave them a copy of it. And so when I did the final, and Lee likes writers. He's crazy about writing. He likes people who can write, you know. Mm-hmm.
And so he signed you in, you got in.
And the fact that I could act very well and I was a writer and Susan backed me up, it got me in. And
so who's some of the people that you worked at the Actors Studio with the scenes? I mean, Marlon Brando, they were all there.
Well,
Marilyn Monroe was even there.
But that was before my time.
Now. I know. Now you're in the 60s. Who was there at the time?
Well, I mean, I worked with good moderators too, you know, like Lee Grant and Shelley Winters. I studied 3 years with Shelley, you know. I was with a very, very, very good teacher.
Good actress.
Wonderful actress and a wonderful teacher. She knows.
What do you mean she's a wonderful? What did you learn from her?
Well, she knows all about how to approach a part, how to get into, make a preparation and getting into a part and working moment to moment. She believes in none of the theatrical tricks. Everything has to be really from the heart and soul.
Right.
And understand exactly what your action is, what the character is, even though. A lot of people don't like to talk about action in the Actors Studio because that's a big Sal Adler thing.
Right.
Know? Lee never liked action. But Shelley was very good, and I had Arthur Penn in New York.
Right.
I worked with him, and I worked with Martin Landau. He moderated for a long time, Martin Landau and Lee Grant, and then recently for a while...
Lee Grant's in New York.
Yeah.
Martin Landau's here at the Actors Studio.
Yeah.
Now, I'm going to ask you a question.
And Mark Rydell. Mark Rydell,
we're going to see tonight, matter of fact. He's doing a play tonight,
after
a reading.
Fall.
After the Fall. It's our Arthur Miller thing.
Yeah.
So tell me, I must ask you, to be a good actor, listen and react. Is that the whole thing about good acting?
Very much.
Isn't it?
Listening.
Spencer Tracy always says.
Listening, yeah.
It's listening.
Yeah.
To you, and then react to that.
Yeah, right. Listening.
That's what Shelley Winter says.
Yeah, reacting. Listening very close. Listening to what the person not only is saying, but what the person's feeling.
Feeling.
Yeah, what is happening to that person. He could be saying, I love you, and be feeling, I hate you.
Right.
You know, it's a
you look at them in the eyes,
yeah,
and let their expressions and that whole thing. Tell me about your, when you got back from Europe, you did some films, and you did De Niro, and you did Barfly and all that. Tell me about Barfly.
I worked Barfly with Mickey Rourke, but I worked Taxi Driver first.
That was before Barfly.
Was
Robert De Niro.
Yeah, I was auditioning, and I got back from Europe. I was just, like, in Europe, and I got back, and De Niro was doing Godfather 2.
Right.
And I called him up and I said, "Geez, I'm glad you're doing pretty well because Mean Street became a big hit, you know."
Right.
And he said, "You want to work in Godfather?" I said, "Yeah, sure." He said, "Well, let me talk to Coppola." And so I worked 6 weeks, you know.
How is Coppola to work with?
Oh, he's a wonderful man.
Is he?
He was very, very wonderful.
Yeah.
But a lot of authority, a lot of strength. He doesn't fool around. He knows exactly.
That's the business.
You know, he goes right to it. But he takes a long time, and he wants to get it right. But boy, that Paramount studio came down to. They were shooting on 6th Street in New York, and I was living on 7th Street, a block away. I never lived so close to location. I would roll out of bed,
I
was on location. And I was in a 1918 sequence with a bowler hat and heavy coat and all that. As this Italian, you know, in the Sicilian street, you know.
You're probably Italiano.
Yeah.
Okay.
But then after that, I didn't have much to say, Godfather. But I did have a good, nice little scene in Taxi Driver with De Niro in the cafeteria scene with Peter Boyle.
Right.
And that was a nice little moment.
Tell me about Faye Dunaway and Mickey Rourke. I love Mickey Rourke.
Well, Mickey and I knew Mickey before he made it.
Really?
Yeah.
Where'd you meet him?
When he was struggling at the Actor's Studio, he knew that I did house painting jobs because I used to paint to make a living. So I hired him a few
times. Today the actors are waiters.
Yeah.
In your days, they were
house painting, moving jobs.
Matter of fact, you moved
Judy
Garland.
Yeah. Well, that was in 1960. She was moving to Cape Cod with Minnelli. She had just finished a big hit at Carnegie Hall. You know that record came out,
course,
Judy at Carnegie?
Course.
And I was doing a moving job, and I was packing her clothes in the hallway.
Uh-huh.
I didn't know it was her. They sent me down there, you know. My boy said, go down to the Dakota House on the third floor and report to so-and-so. They didn't tell me who I was moving. And then I hear this voice coming down the hallway singing, you know, the gal that got away, or the man that got away, and this and that.
Uh-huh.
And I thought it was a record.
Uh-huh.
And I turned around, and there it was, Judy Garland singing down the hallway. And I said, my God, what am I going to do when she comes near me? What do I say to this woman? So she finally came into the bedroom where I was packing the clothes.
Right.
And I said, what do I say to that? And she came in, and she said, how's it going? And I said, oh, fine.
She didn't say, don't touch my clothes or anything, like frantic.
But no, she was
She's
singing
crazy,
and carrying
her.
On. And,
yeah.
then, and I said, what do I do with those curtains? And she looked at me and said, I don't care. Do what you want with them.
I
take them down.
That's
leave
right.
them And then I said, Miss Garland, and she was gone.
Uh-huh.
And that was the last I had with Judy
Harry Cohn, I'm looking at you. You've had some tough years. Come on, let's be. You were an alcoholic, drugs, the 60s. You took it all.
Yeah.
You took all the crap.
Yeah, I
Harry
was a,
Cohn,
I was a
you
Bukowski
your life out.
I was like a Bukowski character.
Yeah, you really. But you were in heavy drugs, loud voice.
Yeah.
Tell me, what happened?
Well, I got very strong into alcohol. I was hanging out with a lot of heavy drinkers. I wasn't working at the time. Things were not going good.
I felt sorry for you.
My beard grow long. This kid was more in Hollywood. And I used to go to Big Sur, and, you know, we used to drop acid and go on trips and do that kind of stuff.
Right.
And meanwhile, I was letting a lot of years go by, and I wasn't working, you know, and I wasn't getting anywhere. I was having a good time with these drugs, or I thought I was.
Were you really having a good time? You don't.
Well, some trips
remember.
I thought were pretty good.
Uh-huh.
Basically, they were not that good.
Right.
The alcohol became very serious, and I couldn't stop drinking, and I was losing a lot of casting jobs. I'd go up for good parts, you know.
Uh-huh.
and I would come half drunk, sometimes pretty loaded. And matter of fact, once upon a time in the in America, that Leone,
right,
the Italian director who had died, Sergio Leone, the great Italian
right.
director.
Wonderful.
I was up for a part because Bobby De Niro told him to look at me because, you know,
yeah.
I'm Jewish. It was about the Jews, you know,
yeah,
in New
of
York.
Course. Who else can do it, right?
And I, yeah, yeah, and I came in, I was half ripped on whiskey, you know.
Uh-huh.
And they just didn't want to deal with me. They felt that, you know, I was going to be a problem.
So how did you straighten yourself out? Who suggested?
I finally went to some AA meetings.
But who suggested it?
A director. Actually, it was a guy, a man who was a friend, William Bell. He was a very good actor, and he was with the Actor Studio, and he directed me. And he said, "Harry, you got to do something about your alcohol. You're not, you know." And he was a very spiritual man. Matter of fact, he hung out in India for a while.
Right.
And he got through to me on a spiritual level.
That's how he got through, Harry Cohn?
He got through to me on a spiritual level.
So what happened? You went to the AA?
And I finally said, you know, I got to really, you know, I really got to take you serious. You know what you're talking about.
Right.
And I went to my, I was on the phone. I went to my room and I threw the bottle into the garbage. I emptied out the vodka, cheap vodka. And then I went to an AA meeting, and then from then on, it's 15 years now.
People at AA,
as a matter of fact, yesterday was my birthday.
They sit there, and they explode everything out of your life, don't you, Harry?
Oh,
they
know,
cry,
it's very revealing.
It's
one of the most...
shameful, like...
Yeah, but you know, AA is more than just about alcohol. It's about a way of life. There's so much about how people talk about building themselves up and character work and working on relationships.
Right.
And it's not always people talking about how...
Alcoholism.
Yeah,
I know.
Alcohol,
right.
You know. And I was very fortunate to get through that because I was getting nowhere and I was, you know, going down the tubes, as they say, you know. But now...
Are you happy now?
Now
I'm
happy now. I got a film that's going to come out maybe next year. It's
really?
Called...
What
I
is
the
it?
Lead, a male lead in it.
Good.
It's a family type film where I play a man of the household who's a con artist. And
right.
But I wear very nice clothes and I have a swimming pool, and, you know,
uh-huh.
you know, upper middle class.
Uh-huh.
And then I did a film in Budapest with John Hurt and Gerard Steiger.
Great.
Yeah. Called Living on Borrowed Time.
And when is that coming out, Harry?
Well, they're trying right now to get it released. They're trying to get someone to...
So you keep yourself busy.
Yeah.
The theater has been great joy for Harry Cohn.
It has really done a lot for me.
Has it?
It's made me feel, I've really grown a lot. I think if it wasn't for Stella and the theater, I'd probably be still living in New York. Not saying that I wouldn't be happy,
yeah.
But I think I'd be just driving a truck and, you know, and... maybe bringing up a family, but I would not be. I don't think I would have explored what I have explored.
Do you regret that, not having a family?
Yeah, in a way.
Huh?
Yeah.
Harry, look at me.
Yeah.
Any regrets about that? Really?
Yeah,
you do?
Sure, because I.
What has been the toughest thing for Harry Cohn? What has been the toughest?
About the family?
Life.
Life?
Life itself, Harry. Not just acting, life for you.
The toughest thing was. Was actually learning how to love yourself.
Love yourself? Be kind to yourself.
Be kind to yourself, because...
How did you find
always,
this?
I was always hard on myself.
How did you find this discovery? Who discovered this?
Through the traveling, through people, through the theater, through Stella, through...
Because we have a lot of violence out there.
You know,
and we got to be a little kinder
through
to ourselves.
AA,
loving
a lot
other.
Of AA does that. But yeah, I never got to love and respect myself as much, and that was a hard thing because I was brought up in a hard way. You know, I was brought up with criminals and hard, you know, I was in institutions, reformatories, and I was with very bad, you know, guys like Manson and people like that, you know.
Right.
Although Manson
But look
was,
what happened to Harry Cohn.
Yeah, yeah.
That's great, Harry. That's great.
It's really like...
They talk about you at the Actors Studio a lot.
Yeah.
Shelley Winters, Lee Grant, they all talk about Harry Cohn. What... This man has leveled to himself, became... Do you go around prisons or any places or drug places and talk?
You know something you that you mentioned that's very interesting? When I was in New York, I joined the Theater for the Forgotten. And Theater for the Forgotten New York, is run by the state of New York. It's a paying job.
Right.
And I went with a couple of people, and this was like in 75, and we did the Zoo Story by Edward Albee. Mm-hmm.
The two
and
characters.
We went to Sing Sing, Alcatraz, that's in California, no.
Yeah.
Attica.
Attica.
It's an A.
That's
you know,
New York.
Attica
yeah.
And Rikers Island and all these prisons and New Jersey and Brooklyn and all that. Uh-huh. And did the Zoo Story, traveled all these prisons doing a play for the prisoners.
Crazy play. That is a crazy play.
And it's a very hard play. And also it was very, it was a very kind of like tremendous experience to work, to do a play for prisoners who don't know anything about language or anything about, you know, like we went to Sing Sing and it was hot and, and it was a room like 300 prisoners.
Right.
And the blacks on one side and the whites on the other because they don't mingle, you know, they separate.
Uh-huh.
And if they don't like you, they stomp their feet, they throw their shoes at you. The guards,
I know.
There's only five guards watching 300 guys. They
it's
can't, you
tough,
know,
yeah.
All they can do is escort you backstage and get you the hell out of there. But I was doing the play with a black actor, and I'm a very good actor, and we did the Zoo Story, you know,
uh-huh.
It's a two-character play.
I know.
And I played the wild guy.
The crazy guy.
Yeah, and
sitting next to his
lunch,
on the park.
On the bench, right.
Right.
And at the end of the play, he tells the guy to pick the knife up, mm-hmm. to, you know, and then I spit in his face, and the black audience, the guy, because he was a black man, I spit in his face. The audience would get up, and they start screaming at him, and they yell. And then finally, when I get knife at the end, they were applauding. They were uh-huh. glad I was dying. It was like live, you know, live theater.
Harry Cohn. Does Harry Cohn know who he is now? Now.
Beginning,
right?
Yeah. You know, I don't really.
You're getting to begin to know.
Yeah, I have more to learn.
And you're writing
I
now.
Know,
you're
I
writing
know,
poetry.
I know. I write poetry now. I write plays.
What kind of poetry do you
do? Three or four plays.
What kind of poetry do you do?
Well, I write kind of like some wild hippie poems, and I've written some alcohol poems. I wrote a poem about something that had to do with Mount Everest and it had to do with...
You went to Mount Everest.
Yeah, base camp. Not the top.
No,
the 16,500.
Well,
the top is 29,000.
Yeah.
No, I went to the bottom.
The bottom.
But it took 10 days to travel through all that, you know, through
right,
the Tibetan
right.
country and all that.
Uh-huh.
And, but yeah, I wrote a thing about that and... I can recite it if you want to hear it.
Go ahead, do it. We are just going to read the credits
it's
and
only
you carry
2 minutes.
On. Go ahead.
Do it now.
Harry.
No matter where I turn, there are these doors behind my head. The puddles of heavy sweat trail from behind me as I walk from the city of love. The telephone poles came to an end, and the rolling children rolled naked down the mountain towards my feet. My suitcase fell to the ground and split open, revealing old photographs in golden frames. I ate the children's apples as I watched them bury the old photos, and then we danced in the middle of the world, and my clothes just flew off.
Beautiful, Harry. Thank you very much.